that comes from Psalm 106. I'll read the whole and encourage you to read your part that says, people. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For God's steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty doings of the Lord or declare all his praises? Happy are those who observe justice, who do righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, when you show favor to your people. Help me when I deliver them, that I may see the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory in your heritage. Let us pray. As we worship this morning, O God, we pray that your Spirit will be our strength, your word will be our guide, your love will be our comfort, and your promises will be our hope. This we pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Join with me as we stand in body or spirit and sing our opening hymn today for praise to the Lord, all the way my Savior leads me. Hear our call to confession. This is the covenant which I made with the house of Israel, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it upon their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. I will forgive their evil deeds, and I will remember their sin no more. In penitence and in faith, let us confess our sins before Almighty God. Together, merciful God, you pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you, our God. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness, in your great compassion, cleanse us from our sins. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore to us the joy of your salvation and sustain us with your bountiful spirit. Amen. Friends, the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare unto you in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. May the God of mercy, who forgives us all our sins, strengthen us all in goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us till eternal life. Amen. Let us pray as we come to the reading of sacred scripture. O Lord our God, your word is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, that we may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We have a couple of scripture passages, one from the Old Testament, from the Hebrew scriptures, and it begins in Exodus chapter 32. It's about the golden calf that was made. When the people saw that Moses was long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioned it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward they sat down and ate and drank and got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people whom you brought up out of Egypt have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'There are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone, so that my anger may burn against them and I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation." But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "O Lord," he said, "why should your anger burn against your people whom you brought up out of Egypt with great power and mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land. I promise them, and I will be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our New Testament gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, beginning in verse 1. It is the parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. The oxen, the fatted calf have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the streets and corners and invite all to the banquet table, anyone you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, 'How did you get in here without wedding clothes, my friend?' The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Years ago, as a young man, I say years ago, I had the opportunity of spending some time, my wife and I, in Mexico City.
And one of our favorite things was, of course, besides seeing the wonderful culture there and the museums, was to go shopping. Now, I remember I hadn't been there very long, a few days, and I went back to the same place to shop, and there was a new person there at one of my favorite shops. So I presented to him the total price of an item that I just had to have. It was a beautiful hat. And I said, here's the price. And he came back with a figure that I thought was a little high. But I didn't want to disturb anything arguing with him. And so I was pulled out my billfold, getting ready to pay him, when an older woman stepped up and said to the man who was selling, which he was a new fellow there, and she told him, best I could understand, that the price was too high, and you should offer him less. And she began haggling with him, had a price, reached over and had my money in my hand. She took the money out of my hand, gave me money back, and there you go. And she turned to me and she said to me, something I'll never forget is that he was just trying to make conversation. Yes. Interesting. Haggling over money in that culture is a sign of inviting one into intimacy and in conversation and perhaps into genuine friendship. And that's how it was. I remember, I'd never thought of that, about how making a friend in a marketplace, you had to bargain with someone a bit in order to do. Now, the thought of haggling over for me is not my idea of having a good time. But this woman forced me to say that it was what I was doing by being quiet and just handing him the money was not okay. The possibility that my silence could be construed as being insulting or disinterested. I'd never thought of that. Conflict arose over prices day by day, and as we continued our time there, and I kept remembering I needed to haggle and to move beyond my comfort zone. I needed not to be silent. I needed to reach out and try to make some new friends. They would smile, and we would talk as best we could. Pushing away people, business people in this story, but pushing people away when they were trying to reach out to me was not acceptable. And it was a lesson I learned the hard way. Our scripture passage today, practically since the day God had delivered the Egyptians, the Israelites had been pushing God away. They did it when they didn't like the food. They did it when they were complaining that the water was too salty. They would complain and murmur and go on and on. They kept pushing God away, frightening to talk to him. So finally, in this passage that we read today, we hear when Moses was otherwise preoccupied up on the Sinai mountain getting the Ten Commandments, they shoved God completely aside and replaced their creator with a golden calf. They created themselves. When God saw the rejection, God told Moses, "You go back down there. These are a stiff-necked bunch. I led them out of Egypt. And I guess I'm not enough for them. Let me alone, God says. God told Moses, so I can let my anger burn against them and consume them. And then I will make of you, Moses, a great nation. God may have said, let me alone at this point, but God's actions of going to Moses with the complaint speaks louder. It somehow reminds me of my 9-year-old when he doesn't get his way. He folds those arms and says to him, you leave me alone. When in fact what he's wanting is a hug and a talk and inviting intimacy, speaking to me face to face. Leave me alone. Just when they want us to hold them the closest. It's not a desire for isolation. It is a desire for an invitation to talk. God sought out Moses to talk about his burning anger. And Moses willingly responds precisely by ignoring God's spoken demand for solitude. You see, there are long years of mutual trust and friendship between God and Moses gives him the ability to know God's desires for his people, even when God's express wishes are to do them in. So Moses dares to argue with God, almost as an equal person. Of course, that's not the case. First, he appeals to God on the relationship and saying, oh Lord, you have had this relationship with these Israelites for so long, God, and these are your people. You brought them out of Egypt. It is your relationship with them. They would not be here if it were not for you, oh Lord. Please don't let your anger burn against your people whom you brought out of Egypt, whom you by your mighty hand have brought them to this day. After this opening volley, Moses continues, heavens, what will the neighbors think? The Egyptians, why, you brought them out here to the mountain to just wipe them out, to get rid of them? And what about your promise to our ancestors, your trusted servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore to multiply their descendants? Upon hearing these words, just upon Moses' passionate response, God's anger and hurt, God relents and changes his mind. Go figure. The picture painted here is one of intimacy. God wanting to bring the people to him and being enraged about their stubbornness and stiff-neckedness and the sense of them pushing God away. It was two friends struggling to deal with the betrayal of a third. To be sure, the partnership is not equal, entirely equal. God does indeed have the power to carry out his threats on the Israelites. And Moses is only mortal who makes his own mistakes in the unfolding of his relationship with God. But here, in this moment, God opens God's very self to Moses, expressing doubt, frustration, hurt, anger, rejection of the people God had chosen to be God's friends. In that moment, God is vulnerable, and in that vulnerability seeks out a trusted companion for solace. And there is Moses. You see, God is not an impregnable fortress of relentless will Our God yearns for relationships with us. And that yearning allows God to be open, to be susceptible to us and our actions. Moses, God's friend, returns the favor by arguing God out of God's chosen course. Moses haggles with God and saves the relationship with the Israelites. In stark contrast of the intimacy between God and Moses portrayed here in our text, we find our New Testament lesson of Matthew remember a story Jesus told when he sent out the king there, had a wedding banquet for his son, and he sent out his servants to summon the invited guest. It's ready. The wedding banquet's ready. Y'all come. But they refused. A second time, the king sent out more servants and urged the intended guest that had been invited to share the joyful celebration that had been prepared. The food was coming out of the kitchen. And a second time, they refused. They refused to the point of killing the ones who brought them the invitation. Angrily, the king punished them for their rejection and sent his servants into the streets, to the highways and byways, to invite anyone they could find. And on this third attempt, the king at last was successful, and the people, bad and good, responded to the king and streamed into the fellowship hall, into the wedding banquet. One way to hear this story is to identify the guests who refused the king's invitation as the Jews. The Jews of Jesus' day who rejected and killed him and their own prophets. God's anger is thus justified, and God destroys their city, Jerusalem, in 70 AD with the Roman Revolution. This is an easy way to listen because it lets us off the hook. Jesus is talking to those bad old people over there and not us good ones who come to the party as soon as the doors open. But I believe Jesus is talking to us, that we reject God's invitation to celebrate just as frequently as any other group of people who we might name. God has called us to sing and to shout for joy, to feast and to play, and we have been too busy, too tired, too weary to respond to God's call to party. Just in case we might try to point to others as the corrupt, the ones who chose not to have relationship with God, Jesus continues. I think it's another parable, 2 in 1, if you would. When the king enters the banquet hall, now filled with people, eager to join in the fun, he sees a man who has not prepared himself. He's not appropriate for this great occasion. The king says, "Friend!" He approaches him with open arms and an open heart. "How did you get in here without wearing a robe, a wedding robe?" And the man, with the same show of indifference that the original invitees, the original guest had, who would not come, with the same unwillingness to participate in a relationship with God as the Israelites, with the same defiance and disinterest I displayed in not haggling with the fella over a price to become conversation and friend. This man refused to respond. We might want to say that the king's subsequent reaction, casting the man out into outer darkness, was unfair. After all, the guest had not had time to get ready because the invitation had come unexpectedly. Yet, somehow, we might note, all the other people were in their wedding garments and had found a way to comb their hair, brush their teeth, and put on the fresh clothes for the wedding and to show up. They got themselves ready to respond, even in a very short time, to the joyful marriage of the king's son. No, this person, who had the same amount of time to prepare for the celebration, chose not to respond in kind. And when he was given the opportunity to explain himself, an opportunity extended in friendship and trust, he said nothing. I cannot help but think if he had just said something, anything, if he had just responded to the king, would have been gracious and excused him, even chosen him to remain as a guest. But the man just stood there, his silence insulting his host and clothing. The door was shut to friendship with the king. He was indeed called, but by his actions, he refused to be chosen. All too often, brothers and sisters in Christ, we are the guest spurning God's call to rejoice in our new relationship made possible by Jesus. God calls us to celebrate, and we answer at will half-heartedly. We don't bother to change our clothes. We don't bother to get ready for the celebration of our lives. God calls us friend, and we just stare ahead, absent-mindedly wondering if we turned off the iron, whether we unplugged turned the dishwasher off, weighing our pros and cons of some glib retorts that we will make to each other before we leave, and in our unwillingness to respond with the same eagerness and openness with which God calls us, we offer yet one more insult to God in a long history of insult and rejection. And yet, in spite of our insult, in spite of our indifference, in spite of everything, God never gives up. God may say, "Let me alone," but it always means, "Come back to me, stay with me, be my companions and my friends." God may let us stew in the oily, ultimately, life-sapping juices of idol worship, or sit alone in the deepest prisons of our outer darkness, but God will never allow us to stay in those places for long. For our God, the friend of Moses, the sender of the Christ, the lover of all creation, will always uncover the lid, open the window, and call out, "Friend, come to the party and celebrate the marriage of my child." Let it be so. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Join with me as we stand and sing "The Old Rugged Cross."
In body or spirit, let us raise ourselves and proclaim that it is by God's grace we are here, and God calls us friend to live for Him.
Thank you. You may be seated. wonderful song. We come to the time of giving. We encourage you to form good giving habits as God is generous and calls us to be the same. So if you haven't developed a habit, this autumn's a good time to do that. There are boxes here by the door, an offering box. I believe there's another one inside the fellowship hall. You can give through online by using b1community.org, or you can just call the bank and say, I'd like to set this up on automatic, or drop a check in the mail to the office here on Elm Street. Wonderful opportunities to form good habits and to celebrate the opportunities we have to be God's partners, God's friends, in making this world a world of grace and hope into the darkness because of Christ's light given to us. Let us pray. Lord our God, we acknowledge that you are our Father and we are your children. Our neighbors, you desire to be our brothers and sisters in Christ. To their service and to your glory, we dedicate ourselves, our hearts, our minds, our wills, our works. Strengthen our resolve to stand fast in your faith, to seek the help of your Holy Spirit, and to work willingly for your perfect kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Would you join me as we stand and sing our doxology? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. May be seated. Part of our response to God's word in song and scriptures and in message is to be mindful of the opportunities we have to pray together for God's world. Join with me. Gracious God, who supplies us with every blessing in abundance, lift up our hearts in gratitude and thanksgiving. Open us to remember the gifts we seldom notice, the bounty we take for granted, the rich possibilities you provide, for bread without scarcity, for water that is pure, for houses to live in, and friends to enjoy. We give you humble thanks. We lift to you all those whose lives are linked with our own. We remember all those whom we name to you now in silence. Touch their lives with your grace and your peace, that they would know your love in these days of illness and unknowing and struggle. In the days ahead, may we be more aware of the bounty for which we need to be grateful, and for all the little things that make us who we are, which we often overlook or ignore. Help us to be more mindful every day of your goodness and love, for beauty and bounty, for healing and hope, for the gospel of our salvation. We lift our voices in praise to you. We pray as one now. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Join with me as we sing our hymn, God of Our Fathers, as we hold faith in our hearts, being ready to give it away. Thank you. You may be seated. Want to thank those of you who are viewing online for tuning us in. We hope you'll share where to find us at b1community.org or on the YouTube. It's been a joy to have you in our viewing today as part of our worship. Tell a friend and come and be with us as you can.